If you love liberty, declare your independence by signing the Shire Society Declaration at shiresociety.com.
All right, I have 1:30 by my watch, so I would like to open the hearing on House Bill 436, please. And Representative, welcome. Frank, sponsor of the bill, will present it. I would note before we start that we have a lot of folks wishing to speak on this issue, all in support. So as you prepare your remarks, I would ask that you try not to repeat those who've gone before you in the interest of expediency. All right? So,
thank
Representative,
you,
thank you.
And thank you for having me present HB 436, enacting exempting persons using virtual currency for registering as money transmitters. I'll keep my remarks short since there are so many people that do want to speak in support. And this bill provides an exemption to the New Hampshire Bank Department's money transmitters license for persons using virtual currency, such as Bitcoin. This is a relatively new industry using blockchain technology, of which I can't explain any of to you. I'm sure someone here will be able to do that. And that's the main reason I sponsored HB 436, was to encourage innovation in New Hampshire, hopefully increasing jobs and growing along the way. So that's basically it. The New Hampshire Consumer Protection Act will be regulating these folks that use it without money transmitter's license if there's any problems. We also had a letter from when it was in the House from the Chamber of Digital Commerce. And basically, the Chamber is encouraging New Hampshire to enact this bill to eliminate any that sweeps in the money transmitter businesses, causing blockchain companies to leave New Hampshire. And with that, I'd love to take any questions.
Thank you. For the record, owner of Bitcoin, may or may not have a conflict, declaring that I will continue to participate. Would you consider it to be a friendly amendment if we change line 7 to effective date on passage versus 60 days old? Thank you. And for the record, can you describe what the amendment was done? So how is the bill different than that was introduced?
To make sure that as we eliminated them regulating these particular persons involved in this bill, that they would be subject to provisions of RSA 358-A, as you see in the end of 6-A. So it would be three times if you have more damages due for the consumer's protection.
I apologize, I missed that. So under consumer protection, you get triple damages? Mm-hmm. What's it doing?
It would come under there instead of under regulations of bank.
Thank you very much.
So does this mean that these entities would be exclusively dealing in alternative forms of currency?
Could you explain?
As opposed to a traditional money transmitter where I can go to a corner store in Manchester and use U.S. dollars and have them sent to Mexico or to another.
Follow up if I may.
So in the instance where someone is dealing in traditional currency and someone is dealing in this alternative, how's the consumer going to know who to complain to if their currency doesn't make it? If they're
the answer, first they probably call the state information or go to their bank or something if they have a problem, right? I mean, if you have a problem with, have,
If I may, I would guess they go to the banking department. I'm not sure there'd be relief there. And we do have two speakers from the banking department to follow the representative, so.
Can I answer? I would point out, which Representative Hunt helped me with, on the new paragraph, section 6A, this would be persons engaged in the business of selling or issuing payment instruments of stored values solely in the form of virtual currency. So it's not mixed, like a currency exchange.
Thank you, Representative. I read this as RSA 358A, it comes under the Consumer Protection Act, not the banking, and any complaints would go there. Is that correct, to the Consumer Protection Commission?
Yes.
The Consumer Protection Act has a private right of action that people can do on their own. Banks and insurance companies and other regulated financial entities that fall in the banking department's jurisdiction are exempt from claims under the Consumer Protection Act. So this is clarifying that Bitcoin does not fall within the banking department's jurisdiction. It falls within the Consumer Protection Act, and if you want to bring a consumer protection claim, you can try your luck with the AG's office, or you can try your luck yourself in Superior Court.
Find your favorite trial.
Right.
All right, before we move on, I too own Bitcoin, and may or may not have a conflict, though I don't think I do, and I will be participating. Thank you, Representative.
Thank you very much.
All right, Representative Butler would wish to speak. Representative?
Thank you, Mr. Chair and committee members. For the record, my name is Ed Butler. I'm the state representative from Carroll County District 7, the 10 northern towns of Carroll County. And I have not much to add to the testimony, except to say that currency is currency. This is called virtual currency, whether it is something that you can feel between your fingers or not. And if we are going to regulate third-party transmitters, then that should occur across the board for all kinds of currency, it seems to me. The regulation of virtual currency is minimal at best. This does not regulate a transaction between you and me, as it doesn't in any transaction between fiat currency and virtual currency. It only regulates the third-party money transmitter or currency transmitter, and those are thousands of registered third-party transmitters throughout the state. I thought that there would be a few. It would be those at Walmart and those you can get at Hannaford and all the others, but they're, each of the branches is registered with the banking department. So there are over 3,000 that are registered. Mm-hmm. I don't imagine that there are many third-party money transmitters dealing with virtual currency. But it seems as it should be what's good for the goose is good for the gander. There was concern that New Hampshire could be this over-regulated place for people who are dealing in virtual currency, and that this bill in particular could restrict in some way the virtual currency industry so that it would not grow and flourish in New Hampshire. But New Hampshire is a base for the virtual currency industry in a way that many states are not. We already are encouraging transactions and entrepreneurship in virtual currency more so than in many other states. I think that this very minimal oversight is reasonable and shouldn't necessarily be negated simply because the industry is fearful of any kind of regulation.
Question?
Sir?
Representative Ed Camo from Carroll 5 supports, does not wish to speak. Commissioner Jerry Little from the Banking Department opposes, wishes to speak. Commissioner.
May I bring Marianne Corbin DeFoss with me, please?
Pardon?
May I bring Marianne with me? She's our subject matter expert at the Banking Department, and she is right underneath me on the signing list.
All right. Gotcha, both.
So we're getting the twofer.
You're getting the twofer, and all the hard questions you can direct. Good afternoon. My name is Jerry Little. I am your bank commissioner. This is Marianne Corbin DeFoss.
And here's the examiner with the department.
We are here today in opposition to the bill. I wanted to make that clear because at the outset you said that everybody was in time at this.
Yeah, I missed that. Support. You're in opposition. There's one other as well.
We have steadily opposed this bill from the day that we read it. Mm-hmm. I think the fundamental question to you is, do you want the FAA examining the airplane on the ground before it takes off, or do you want the TSA looking for the black box after it crashes? That's the issue that we're dealing with here. Do you want somebody in charge, responsible, to take a look at these businesses before they set up business, before they take flight in the state of New Hampshire, or do you want somebody going around cleaning up the mess after the crash? This is not an if situation, it's a when. So to be clear about this bill, it doesn't attempt to regulate in any manner your purchase of a business account. It doesn't attempt to regulate in any way your personal use, you to somebody that you want to pay to with Bitcoin. It's no attempt to get to understand where that Bitcoin is eventually going, should you choose to use an electronic service to transfer that Bitcoin. It is an attempt to license, take a look at before we allow them to go ahead and have an opportunity, a regulatory method that we can use to take a look when we get problems about this at that third-party vendor who says that there's a business opportunity for me here to insert myself between that consumer owning a Bitcoin and the person that they want to send that Bitcoin to for the purchase of compact discs or a room in an inn. When they make that decision that they want to be an intermediary between those two parties, that third party, that's where the state gets to have some responsibility to make sure that it's the FAA on the ground and not the TSA afterwards. This proposes to exempt that industry from any oversight by the state of New Hampshire. We know that things go wrong. We have historically in the past regarding the transmission of virtual currency. We know they will go wrong again in the future. And so the question remains that if we allow this to happen in New Hampshire, who are you going to look at and say, one, how did this happen? Should you have let it happen? Who's going to fix the problems? Who's going to make these consumers whole? And in this bill, you're saying we're not worried about that. If it crashes, it crashes. Have the outcome. These consumers are on their own. We also know that when it crashes, people look around. And if it has to do with money transmission, finances in any way, they look at the banking department and they say, where were you? And we're only going to be able to say, we were told to stay away. We were told to look in the other direction. We have an issue. There are three initials. Starts with financial resources. Goes to mortgage. FRM. And in the past, we had a situation where it was entirely unclear who had responsibility. In this piece of legislation, we know it's not us, but we also know that when things go wrong with the financial services, consumers, public policy makers, opinion makers, leaders in the state of New Hampshire want to know, where was the banking department when this went wrong? And so the amendment that you've seen, and I want to be clear, that we proposed this piece of legislation when asked what our oppositions were, we said all of this, and then we also said, so you need to make sure that you know who's responsible. Who are people going to point to when things go wrong? Not if, but when things go wrong. Make sure it's not us, because you're telling us to look the other way. And so if that's what you really want us to do, you should make it clear, overtly, have a positive statement in the legislation that says it's somebody else that's responsible for fixing this. And that's where the amendment came from, that we were asked to draft, and when we were asked by the Commerce Committee on the House side to draft the amendment, we made it clear again that we're opposed to the piece of legislation. But we did draft legislation that made it clear that, as Mr. Lehman has told you, that absent regulation by one of your agencies, and then the Consumer Protection Act holds sway, has jurisdiction, which means that you go out and you find yourself a lawyer, and you take civil action, as opposed to being regulated by the banking department, where we have the authority to go into one of the regulated entities, which this currently is, which it will not be, if you pass this, and we suggest you ITL this piece of legislation. If it's still licensed and regulated by the bank department, consumers call us, they bring the complaint to us, we do an investigation, we have legal authority to order full, complete restitution immediately. Compare that to the scene that you are contemplating, which is you've lost your $10,000, your $20,000, your $100,000 in Bitcoin. Go get a lawyer. Spend the money on a lawyer. Go through the Superior Court system. Take the time, and you may or you may not get the money back if you can find the company, because they can be anywhere on the face of the earth.
We have a question, but I can add it all if you want to ask.
If you have not finished, I'll certainly wait.
Essentially, just to reiterate, we don't regulate the technology. We don't regulate the blockchain. And there's a misnomer that we regulate the blockchain. We support the blockchain. We don't regulate it. Technology, all sorts of uses can be made on the blockchain. We don't regulate the actual underpinning of virtual currency. What we regulate is the use, just like we regulate actual currency, meaning fiat currency, in its use when it goes to a third party. We would regulate this virtual piece. And again, as Commissioner Little said, we have the ability to obtain restitution if necessary without expense to the consumer.
All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both. I guess I just wanted, and maybe you can help me, because I'm way out of my realm here. But if I understood it, the testimony previously was that the only reason I got was that we want to help this fledgling industry. Am I correct in that, or is there another reason for this bill and to exempt, virtual currency?
We have virtual currency transmitters currently licensed by the state of New Hampshire, and while they may not like it, it doesn't seem to be impeding their forward motion. I think that we'll leave the arguments for supporting the bill to people who support the bill. We do not support this piece of legislation. We don't find it unreasonable. Traditional money transmitters have not found it problematic either. As someone said here just this morning, there are thousands of them in the state of New Hampshire, and they do just fine with licensing. It's a very, very, very light regulatory touch.
Thank you.
Isn't this a little bit like the Wild West? It's the ultimate free market in a lot of ways. If you buy Bitcoin, you're taking a risk. You're making an investment, perhaps, trying to play that market, as we do with stocks. If I buy Sears stock today, goes to zero next month, which is possible, that's on me. If I buy Bitcoin today and it goes to zero next month, that's on me. I'm not sure I see this as a bank per se. I guess that to me is a little bit of the distinction.
So sticking with the equities analogy, if I set up a sham company and take your money, you're going to call the SEC and say, this guy lied to me. He didn't file his proper quarterly reports. When he did file the reports, they were misleading, and you're going to try to get your money back. And in this instance, we're saying, don't ask those questions. If this is the Wild West, and you and I meet outside on the chaparral, and we have a disagreement, I shoot you and walk away.
Oh, no.
Okay, you shoot me in. And that's how that story ends. And the question is, do you want to expose consumers in the state of New Hampshire to that situation? Do you want the SEC to be there when somebody sets up a sham corporation, doesn't issue an IPO that is nothing but a ripoff because nobody was checking them out first?
All right. I'll hold my further questions for other witnesses. Yes.
I have two questions, or a couple. And again, I'll always refer to you as Senator because I think it's a higher distinction.
That is an honor. Thank you.
So please take that as a compliment.
Good. Thank you.
And I know that you are not commissioner of the banking department when FRM happened, but I respectfully challenge your proposition that there are many people who believe that the state of New Hampshire, or be it securities or be it the banking commissioner, whoever the third party was, I forget today,
Attorney General,
was overseeing the construct of investment properties and was overseeing the operation and had requirements to disclose and had requirements for quarterly presentations to whichever agency it may or may not have been, and the entity still failed, which would lead some people, maybe someone like me, to question the need or how much government regulation and oversight we need to have, since clearly in that case it didn't do what you're suggesting the bank department does do today, and I think you do it, don't get me wrong. But for those people who say, look, I'm willing to take this risk because clearly the banking department and the Attorney General's office and the security agencies are not infallible, I'll take that risk. Why are you uncomfortable with that? And that's my first question.
So that has to do with only one piece, and that is the amendment that makes it clear who is responsible. One of the problems, and I think if you go back and read the variety of reports that came out of either the Attorney General's office or Mr. Chandler's report out of the Secretary of State's office, or any amount of news media that covered it, is that it was unclear which part of business being done by FRM was covered by which agency. And so in the context of the amendment that suggests that if these entities are exempt from regulation by the banking department, that there should be language that overtly states and makes it clear to everybody, not only is this entity not examined, licensed, or regulated by the banking department, but that anybody that suffers a problem as a result will only have as a remedy seeking restitution under RSA 358A through Consumer Protection Act. So it is simply to make it very, very clear what the remedies are and who's responsible, because that was one of the problems, one of many problems regarding financial resource mortgages, was that there were multiple jurisdictions all found in one agency. And in this instance, we're creating an entity that does not have anybody regulating it, where there are very similar companies, traditional currency transmitters, that are licensed and regulated and examined by the banking department. The only difference here is that we're talking about virtual currency.
So follow up, sorry. Go ahead. Yeah, you know,
I was going to ask, these other transmitters, it's like Western Union, right?
Yes.
Yes.
So Western Union sent like $1,000 under my name to some African nation years ago. I never got it back.
How? What's the difference?
So just today, as a matter of fact.
Purely today,
the FTC announced that it has come to an agreement with Western Union for that type of activity.
$58 million,
correct. I believe, that they have set up restitution, and that they have set up a process for you to, right, with the Department of Justice, for you to apply to recover those funds.
Now, in terms of, let's take your example,
just today,
for instance. Somehow, in some way, money that belonged to you was sent via Western Union, probably a scam and a sham, to some unknown entity.
And they called me an hour after they sent it and said, did you authorize this?
Right.
No, but you sent it. Thanks.
And as a consumer, since we regulate Western Union as a money transmitter, you would be allowed or entitled to file a consumer complaint through our department at no cost to you. We would then process the complaint, go through the process of investigating it, and more likely than not, monies would be returned into your bank account.
Thank you. Question.
The issue here is really about third-party possession. We're not regulating whether you send money directly to another individual. That's a completely different component. And we're not regulating when you use that currency, just like you would use fiat currency to pay for a coffee at Starbucks or a couch on Overstock.com, for example, which you can do with a portion of your Bitcoin, for example.
Yeah.
We're regulating when you're actually having that currency, much like your fiat currency, in the possession or control of a third party, when it's out of your hands. Because virtual currency can be, just like if you have a physical wallet or a purse, and if you lose it, you lose it. Same thing with virtual currency. If you keep your private and public key on your phone or on your laptop, and that hard drive crashes, or if you lose your phone, there goes your money, there goes your Bitcoin. However, if you hold it with a third party who has possession, for example, that's what we control too, the stored value piece, and then the receipt and the transmission limits through that third party, much like Western Union.
So where does an organization like PayPal fit into this?
So PayPal has different components. We regulate a portion of PayPal, much like we regulate a portion of Square, and we don't regulate a portion of PayPal, much like we don't regulate a portion of Square. It depends on what they're doing. If they're holding money and receiving money and transmitting it, we regulate it. If it's peer-to-peer, we don't regulate it. PayPal had a company called Venmo. They actually didn't own it at one point. They now own it. Venmo was a type of PayPal. It was a peer-to-peer, but it held the funds. PayPal now owns it, and it's part of the PayPal license. So it depends on the transmission, again, or the use, I should say. If I were to go in with my dollar bill or 0.0001 of my Bitcoin to buy that cafe latte or that beautiful couch, it's merchant payment processing, it's peer-to-peer. We're not regulating that piece. However, if I were to send it through a third party that isn't merchant payment processing, meaning it's not a contemporaneous processing of the payment for purchase of goods or provision of services like FinCEN has indicated what merchant payment processing is, then you're talking about a third party holding control for later use, for example, that's considered stored value, or transmitting it to another location, that's like Western Union or a money gram, for example.
Okay. All right.
Question?
So you indicated that my good friend, who is incredibly charitable and sends money to Africa on a regular basis to his friends at some money management company, he's that guy.
I'm probably going to get a huge payoff in about 5 years.
Of like 7 cents. So you say more often than not, the banking department is able to recapture money.
Absolutely.
So my question is, how many claims have we been in 5 years, and how many people have gotten full restitution, and how many people have either gotten less than full or no restitution?
Well, in terms of overall complaints, we have, I can't give you a direct number. In terms of Western Union, that number went and skyrocketed when it came to the latter couple of years. And that may or may not have been a portion of what was occurring between the FTC and the DOJ as well. The last few consumer complaints we received regarding Western Union were all sort of sham-type transmissions. One was an elderly individual, and one was just a sham. It was just a sham. We had no clue how it began.
It just
we think it was some sort of internet click or something.
Generally
speaking, from all the Western Union complaints I've seen.
All complaints?
Yes.
All complaints.
Oh, over across the board?
All complaints.
Across the board.
That come to the bank. How many complaints has the banking department seen in the past 5 years?
Of all types of consumer complaints, we get about 100 a year.
Get about 100 a year. So let's say 500 in 5 years. And of that, how many were provided full reimbursement, and then how many were provided either less than full or zero reimbursement?
Okay. So it would depend on the type of complaint. So for example, I'm just going to take categories for now. Money transmission, I would say 99.9% of them were fully given restitution, and that was based on, again, a sham transaction or something that occurred with the transmission number. Those were given back. It gets a little bit more complicated when it comes to resolutions with respect to other types of entities we license and regulate. So for example, mortgage servicers, mortgage bankers, brokers. The types of complaints range anything from the fee itself to certain fees not being disclosed on the HUD settlement statements to inaccurate escrow payments or non-payments or failure to pay for hazard insurance, for example. Issues dealing with non-payment by the servicer to the taxing authority. Automobile complaints, both retail sellers and sales finance companies, those range across the board too, from overpayment to anything dealing with hidden fees, etc. So on those, typically we're pretty successful. It really depends on the type of complaint and what it calls for.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Senator Noxky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you. We have a letter here from Overstock.com, and they state that no other state has put any restriction on licenses. Is that correct?
That's correct, because the use of Bitcoin through Overstock.com is actually merchant payment processing. It's basically using your Bitcoin, much like you would use your credit card or your ATM card or cash, contemporaneous with your purchase of a good. So we would regulate that, and that's the same as FinCEN as well.
So it's not applicable to
our jurisdiction. And we've actually issued letters of no action to many entities regarding that piece of a business model. So we get a lot of inquiries from companies who actually want to get licensed, and then we get inquiries from companies who just want to know where they stand with respect to our laws. And it applies to both money transmission and other sanctions as well. But with respect to this piece, we've actually issued no actions to companies indicating that a portion of their business model, for example, would not be within our jurisdiction because it is merchant payment processing. So we do review every model with as much detail as possible to ensure that it fits within our jurisdiction or it doesn't fit within our jurisdiction.
Thank you.
Further questions?
Thank you. Appreciate your testimony.
Thank you very much.
Representative Hunt, I apologize.
No, that's actually very helpful.
Right. So, Representative Hunt, please join us in support.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's a pleasure once again to be for the Senate Commerce Committee.
Great to meet
you. I'm Representative John Hunt from Williams Jaffrey, Cheshire 11, and I come for you in support of the legislation you have in front of you. And I will have to say that I take some blame for why this is here. Because last year, my friend might remember this, we had a bill, House Bill 666, and which was the recodification of this division within the banking department. It was just a reorganization of the statute. And at that time, what was explained to me when we had this little section about, and Bitcoin is the manufacturers of the convertible currency section, when we had this section in there, it was explained to me that it was no different than Western Union, no problem, we just want to make sure that we treat everybody, every transmitter, equal. And out of due respect to the banking department, I certainly heard them and respected them that they've been doing this already. So there was no reason for us to rock the boat, but we did create a study committee to look into this issue, to really fully understand it. Because, and I will be the first to tell you, because the banking department clearly, and Mary's, she's done a great job in getting her arms around this thing and explaining it to me. It took me multiple hours, and I know this because I had the tape. Well, you can get on the internet, you can get the tape of us trying to, for me to finally get my arms around what this is about, okay? The reason why overstock in effect, because if you're just paying with Bitcoin, we don't care. What this is about is that for some reason, and this is where I really could not get my mind wrapped around this issue, and I still do, and that's the reason why I support this bill, is that for some reason, you have decided to, rather than pay that merchant or pay somebody with the Bitcoin yourself electronically, that's the whole point of Bitcoin, peer-to-peer, right? That's the point. But for some bizarre reason, and I'm emphasizing bizarre because I still don't understand this, you have decided that you're going to walk down to this corner store that offers the service of transmitting your Bitcoin currency, if we're going to call it that, to somebody else who will then deliver it to the merchant. Because if it's peer-to-peer, this is a non-issue. So I'm sitting there trying to say this, why would anybody do this? Well, what's going on here? On my best, and I haven't really got anybody say, you've got it, you now understand, what I think this is about is when you want to change it from greenbacks to Bitcoin.
That's right.
That's what I think this is all about.
There's a fee.
Okay? Because remember, you don't take your greenbacks to, and right now, the Western Union is on the outside. Have you ever tried to do Western Union now? It's a nightmare. I go to Walmart. My daughter needs money in San Francisco. I said, is there a Walmart near by you? Yes. Okay, go on down there. I'll go to my Walmart, wire the money. Okay, I'm not gonna go to Walmart and say, I guess I could go to Walmart and hand my credit card and say, give me some cash back, like a debit card or something like that, but I would just easily go to my bank. I would never ask them to change my money into some other foreign currency so that, and then send that foreign currency to somebody else who lets it get delivered to that merchant. You would never do that. So then, once I understood what this was all about, this legislation, and I certainly have all total respect for the banking department and why they were treating this as equals. Okay? With your Western Union, Walmart money transmitter versus these entities, I understand that all they wanted to do is to say, if they're taking people's money, they're taking people's currency, Bitcoin currency, and they're holding on to it, they're taking it away from you, and they're holding on to it and doing something with it, and when they send it away, or whatever they do with it, that we treat them the same. Just like if you were to go and give that $1,000 to Walmart, and you expect them to send it and deliver it and do what they're supposed to do, okay? So unless it's okay, that's when I kind of let this thing percolate and go along. But then I got to the point where I'm starting to read the newspapers, and everyone who uses Bitcoin is opposed to this bill, opposed to this regulation by the department. Okay, so now we have the issue is, because we're Commerce and Consumer Affairs, okay? That's our title. And so therefore, the consumer, am I benefiting the consumer? Is the banking department benefiting the consumer? Because they have some oversight over these virtual collection centers who are going to take care of sending it off. All right, are we doing this? If no consumer wants it, in other words, we don't have any consumer complaints, and it's funny, I use the airplane, because I always use the analogy, normally we'll wait till the crash, right? We'll wait till somebody's been harmed, and people say, oh my God, you guys need to step in and regulate this business, because look, we're a bunch of people losing money. But I have yet heard anybody who's had any problems with this particular transactions they're doing. I haven't really heard of any of that yet. Okay, and I have no general demand for this. All right, but ironically, we talk about FRM and I know that Senator Susie is also intimately aware of what some of the issues around that issue. At the end of the day, it was the perceived that the banking department was supposed to have some regulatory authority over that. It was the plaque on the wall. Now, as the sponsor of that legislation that gave the bank department restitution authority, sponsor that legislation, as the sponsor who has always been worried about how we work in terms of the department and how to protect the Consumer Protection Act and who's in and who's out, okay? I've done, over the years, this has been one of our major tasks, is who's in, who's out, how we're creating that bright line. When the original bill came in, which was to simply say, okay, we're going to remove the banking department authority over solely, okay, so if Western Union decided they want to take virtual coin, as long as they're doing their other taking dollars, they would not be exempt from the banking union, because that word solely is in there. But that if you're solely in the virtual currency business, and that's all you do, then my better part of valor is let's just let the banking department stay away from this. We are giving the false impression that we are really going to help that consumer. Because what happens if that consumer goes down and gives that virtual currency to this entity, and this entity sends it off to wherever you told them to send it off to, and then somehow the transaction falls through, and they call up the banking department and say, take care of me. So we're going to go down to wherever this virtual currency entity that was in state, okay? In state, we're going to say to them is, okay, what happened? Where's the screw up? We'll make the consumer whole. And I'm sure there's going to be some Bitcoin conversation. I don't know how they have the virtual currency and all the blockchain and then, who knows? But I don't think our banking department needs to be here yet. At some point in time, we may need them to come step in. But at this point in time, this entity, what's going on, we don't have a consumer need for it. It is very micro, it's a very small set of people. It's absolutely the Wild West. And I was agreeable to put the 358A section in here simply to help inform the consumer that if they did think the banking department had regulatory authority, they would know where they need to look. With that, I want to
question.
Good.
Senator Lasky.
Do you mind?
Not at all.
Thank you. He seems to be where he was, where I probably am. Thank you, Representative. I guess I'm still going back to the fact that what you just said is that why don't we wait this out? It sounds like, though, you can sort of see the crash coming, but yet we're not going to do anything to preempt it. Am I correct?
I have total confidence that our banking department will do everything they can to make the consumer whole. If that transaction did start in the state in one of our licensed entities, that I think they can do their best. But I don't know. I don't even understand why anybody would even use these things.
Well,
so in terms of why are we regulating, the industry is so young, it's so immature. Shouldn't we wait until we really know what we're regulating, what we're looking for, what kind of problems we want to look for before we get the banking department over-regulating?
That's my main thing, is that I don't understand why anybody would do it. To me, when you deal one-on-one, you either know who you're dealing with, et cetera. When you get a third party involved, you're looking for trouble.
I would say, that was rude for me to say over-regulating. I would say that they are lightly regulated. They are lightly looking. They're looking at the financial solvability, the same requirements we would have of the rest of you, that of who's operating. I would not say it's highly regulated. I just don't know. I just don't. If none of the people who are using this are asking us for this legislation, then why do we have it?
How many people are using it? Do we know? Do we have a handle on
as far as I know, most people are peer-to-peer. But as I say, have you ever asked a third party to transmit yours, or have you always done it peer-to-peer?
I have not used a second party.
I've done it both ways.
Okay, so you are familiar with the account. So you have in-house help on this one. He's better off than I am.
I could make a glib comment that they're Republicans, but I don't
So we know they're going to lose some money.
And regulations, clearly. All right,
Senator Sam.
But at any rate, thank you.
You're good. Thanks. All right, Senator Sam.
For the record, I might say movement conservative before I'd say Republican, but that might be in the weeds for some people in this room. My concern, frankly, is, and I'd be interested to hear this from anyone else who is pro this legislation, even though I have to leave at this point. I'm surprised you would put a reference to 358 in, because that provides triple damages, so not just damages, but triple damages relative to someone who might be aggrieved. And if people truly believe this is free market, which many of us do, that you would take out any reference to 358 and then truly make it the Wild Wild West, or in my case, truly make it free market. That everything's at risk every day. So my question is, would you be comfortable if we took out the reference to 358 and truly make it what I believe would be free market?
I would say you'd be taking it out, but you would not be getting you would not be accomplished what you want, because I'm of the position that these money transmitters, if they were to harm, if they were to take your money, that what legal rights you have would be under 358A, because they would have fraudulently taken your money as a consumer per transaction. So by my putting us, the House Commerce Committee, it was my amendment, by us putting this 358A in here, is only simply to be informative and help educate the consumer that if they were frauded, what is the proper rights that they have under it. But if taking it out makes you feel better that it's, you know, shouldn't have been in there, I would say to you, that's the way we got the bill. What we did is we just repealed the little stat and language out of it. But we just thought it would be helpful for consumers to know that when something is not regulated by the banking department and they've defrauded you on a financial transaction, that you do have the rights and powers of 358A.
Again, I think you missed my point. I apologize. I'll be very, very quick. My point is prohibit a triple damages under the Consumer Protection Act. If you want to make it truly free market where everyone recognizes they're at risk, isn't that the most pure form of free market?
If you want to revisit 358A, it was not this statute was created before me, so I can't take full blame for it, even though I have defended it a lot. But I would say the triple damages, the intent of the triple damages was simply to allow the consumer to be able to recoup the cost of legal counsel.
Thank you. You know what I'm saying, I apologize, do not mean to be disrespectful to you or anyone else in the room, but I have another point.
Senator Susie.
Representative Hunt, I just want to make sure I understood one part of your evolution or education on this process. You said that you thought these were being used to convert currency?
My suspicion is that's really what's going on here. It's about converting.
So isn't this more, isn't this more like Forex, which is a different type of entity that actually does deal with the exchange as opposed to, and if that's solely the purpose, or primarily the purpose, would you want to do something more like that? Than just,
again, I mean, the industry, the whole thing is so, I think we need to give time before we know what we need to regulate and what the federal government might step in and regulate before we even bother to do it and whether we should do it by an individual state. I personally feel this is clearly an internet type, form of communication. This is a national thing. This is best solved by federal regulation, not state. Having said that in terms of to get to that place, because now you're sending it to a third party who's converted, who's then going to take it and then deliver and then do the conversion. The fact that no one would say, yes, John, that's what this is about, is because it's not technically supposed to be about that. It's only supposed to be about money transmitting. You have to remember, the banking department is very narrow in their task here. Is all they care about is moving that Bitcoin or that whatever crypto technology you're using, moving it from point A to point B, but that A and B are not you and who you are doing business with. So I'd say A, it's B, B and C, but there's A and D on the other side.
So Representative Hunt, as I recall, the study committee that we passed on these other forms of currency had a very long date that it was to remain active. So my understanding is that it still is active. Might it be better to flesh some of these issues out a little more through that committee process than to simply pass this piece of legislation?
No, I think it
will.
Thank you.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Commissioner Little, just a quick question. The volume of transactions, just for perspective here, the volume of transactions with these alternative currencies as opposed to more traditional dollars. Do you have any estimate of that?
So we have three entities, three licensees. And actually, can I make one point before we go into that piece?
Of course.
We do regulate Forex. We actually regulate several Forex companies. In fact, many of them have consent orders with the department for that same thing, which is money transmission. They take control and they possess it and they move it. So we do regulate Forex companies. They are considered money transmitters. With respect to HB 666, we actually licensed three virtual currency companies prior to HB 666 because our statute was broadened up in the definition under monetary value to include virtual currency. The addition of the term virtual currency was only added for the perspective of helping with another bill that had to do with gaming, which we don't regulate. That being said, there were three companies, one of whom has changed its business model, so I don't believe it's doing virtual currency anymore. The other two are going to go into examination or are just beginning the examination or in the middle of it. So I don't have volume. I don't handle the examination piece. I handle enforcement pieces and review business models and the like.
Is it fair to say it's a fractional element of all transactions at this point in our state or not?
In terms of
total transactions, the virtual currencies is just a small piece of the total money transmission.
In terms of money transmission, I can't make that determination because there are hundreds of companies out there that potentially could need to be licensed. We're getting questions, you know, monthly with respect to people wanting to come in. And then, of course, there's the piece we don't regulate. So virtual currency is growing. The issue is, we regulate this portion of it.
Yeah.
That portion, there are many companies out there that handle that money transmission piece that we would like to regulate and continue to regulate because of that third party control.
Sorry to call you back.
Sure.
Just want that clarification. Will you be back?
I will.
All right. We'll probably still be on this. All right. Okay. Let me see, in terms of protocol here, we have Jeremy Kaufman from the governor's office here.
Hi.
Hi. Speaking in support.
Yeah, so just to be clear, I was appointed by the governor as the industry representative on this topic as part of the committee that was formed in the House.
State your name, please, Mr. Director.
Hi, I'm Jeremy Kaufman. So I'm a resident of Manchester, Ward 4. I've been living in New Hampshire for actually just a little bit over a year. And I moved to New Hampshire specifically to work on a blockchain-related business. That business, the name of it is Libraries, spelled L-B-R-Y, not too relevant to the testimony here beyond the fact that it is a business that utilizes blockchain technology. That business has been backed by VCs in Boston as well as some angels in New Hampshire, including Jeremy Hitchcock from Dell. And we employ several people here in New Hampshire working in this industry and in this field. So I want to keep it short. One thing I did want to clarify is that the regulation that is being, or the current regulation rather, does regulate blockchain. That is, it's necessary for these types of tokens to be bought and sold in order for blockchain-based companies to work. So that is, to be clear about my company is not affected by this regulation directly. We do not have to get regulated by the state of New Hampshire. We do, however, have a blockchain-based token, And we are interested in that token being able to be bought and sold. In fact, something that came out of the House testimony has become, from Representative Hunt, is now my new favorite analogy for blockchain, which is whether or not you would regulate Beanie Babies and the sale of Beanie Babies. There are lots of things that have value, and we generally allow these things to be bought and sold, and we don't consider them to be money and to be regulated as money. And so similarly, any blockchain-based business, mine included, needs the ability for these tokens to be bought and sold, and the vast majority of these purchases are not purchases that are designed to be serving as money. The current regulation as written regulates all of these purchases. And in fact, one of the most prominent businesses that left the state of New Hampshire after this bill was passed takes the legal position that they are not a money transmitter. The state of New Hampshire is taking the position that they are, and New Hampshire is now the only state that this business doesn't operate in. And so similarly, my interest here is actually somewhat parochial. I want to go around and talk about how New Hampshire is the best state to start a blockchain business. We have highest per capita blockchain usage of any state in the entire country. And there is an incredible amount of interest here in blockchain, which is why there are 20 people behind me who are interested in seeing this bill pass, and you'll find no citizens in this room who are interested in keeping the regulation as is. So the Overstock bill is mentioned. Overstock is against this bill like just about any other blockchain company, or really any company you'll find. The only companies that are going to be for this regulation are the banks, basically, because they are threatened by what blockchain can do. I do think that it's very important for this is the early days of this industry. It is very, very important that we keep the costs low to operate in this business. And I'll tell you, in my previous business, a company that I started previously, that company deals with moving around, this year it'll move around probably around $20 million in support and activity fees. Dealing with money transmission regulations is an absolute nightmare. You have regulations in 48 different states. And to comply with them, you need to get individually licensed in all 48. The notion that New Hampshire money license transmission is actually preventing any kind of blockchain-related fraud is absolutely ridiculous. No offense taken. I believe they do good work. But the companies that are perpetuating fraud, and they exist. I'm not denying that they exist. They're not being stopped by New Hampshire state regulations. Those companies can set up false accounts. Those companies can do all that stuff no matter what. We're talking about the internet. And so what I would say is if you look at the trade-off between regulating this and preventing, basically nothing, we've seen no instances of a crime, we've seen no reported crimes that would have been prevented by this regulation, and you have thousands of people who are saying, please do not do this, you have myself and lots of other people in a very hot and burgeoning industry who are saying, please leave this industry alone. And that would be essentially my stance, that this legislation is not going to prevent any possible harm, and it does send a very bad signal, and it does make it harder for companies like myself and similar companies to do business here. And I would generally be happy to answer any questions about blockchain or the perspectives of blockchain-based businesses.
Senator French. That's exactly it. What's blockchain?
There's a lot of hype around it. It's really just a new type of database. It's a new type of database technology. I actually will frequently call it the world's crappiest database technology, because the only good thing about it is you don't need to have a single party in charge. That's a very valuable property, and in order to have that property, you need the tokens that back this database to be able to be bought and sold. And the vast, little tokens, they're literally numbers. You're buying and selling numbers that have been cryptographically secured. And it is vital for this technology to work. These tokens can be bought and sold. The vast majority of buying and selling of these tokens is covered by this regulation, but is not done in money transmission.
Oh, you don't? Okay.
You do that as well?
You do not physically hold it.
Well, I
you
guess that's
see
why
it
would
it.
You
pay for the license that gives you the encryption?
You have a key. When you quote own a token, you have essentially, you could think of it as a password to that token. When you issue a command to the system with that password, I can move that token to be owned by someone else.
Sounds real secure.
It's either very secure or very insecure.
All right, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you.
Supporting, not wishing to speak, is William Stearns.
supporting not wishing to speak is Representative Jim McConnell. Supporting not wishing to speak is Robert Galley. Supporting not wishing to speak is Mark Edgington. And we have a number of speakers left, and I truly hate to do what I'm about to do, but I have to ask that we keep testimony short. We have two more bills. We have a hard stop at 3:30. So I welcome everyone on the list to speak, but please be as concise as possible. All right? Okay. Did you wish to speak?
Sure. I saw your hand. You were going to postpone the hearing. I'm a co-sponsor. I just wanted to, if you were going to postpone, if just a few brief seconds to speak.
If you'd like to speak as a co-sponsor, please. Okay. Yes.
So, for the record, my name is Keith Ammon. I represent Hillsborough District 40. That includes New Boston, Mount Vernon, Milton, and Hollis. And I'm a co-sponsor on this bill. And I'll be very brief. I'll make a few points that some of the previous speakers did not make and re-emphasize a few that they may have. It's very interesting that we have this high level of understanding of what we're talking about, because 2 years ago, when Representative Laura Jones introduced what became House Bill 666, and her intention was to protect this industry, this nascent industry, from being overly regulated. That was her intention of submitting her bill. And it got flipped around, and the legislation got put in place that we're trying to back out the screws on a little bit. So the difference in the quality of conversation from back then to now is very encouraging. And I think the internet's gonna like this hearing. Just there's a lot of people, a lot of tech geeks, including myself, find this subject very fascinating. And it is a new form of technology that has potential future uses that have not been built out yet, similar to when the internet was very early. And it's supported by these tokens. These tokens are very critical to this whole thing working and all these future potential use cases working, because the tokens are an incentive mechanism for the people running computer hardware that requires electricity, it requires purchasing the hardware, it requires maintaining the hardware. These tokens are the incentive mechanism that allows this decentralized network, which is literally a global network of all these computers, all these people that don't know each other, they're not friends, they're only doing it for the rational self-interest. Mm-hmm. And these tokens allow that entire network to operate, because the tokens have value in the open marketplace. And when you start to choke that, and remember, this is global, so the phrase that money goes where it's welcome, technology goes where it's welcome. And in this case, we're talking about technology that can be used as money, so it's a double whammy. And if New Hampshire, which it sort of has done, sends the signal that we're not welcome to this new technology, then those jobs, those industries may not come here. And this is a very nascent industry, has been said several times. So any signal that we send now can have drastic ramifications in the future, right? So I made this point in a previous hearing, the butterfly effect. You know, if a butterfly flaps its wings, you don't know what the potential change of course of outcome will be. So that's why we need to be careful now, in my opinion, to not overregulate this, because it may seem like Beanie Babies, but there's a lot here. And I think it was Senator Susie that said, shouldn't we take our time and go back to the commission and study this more? Well, the truth is, this sector of technology is advancing so rapidly that even the experts in technology are having trouble keeping up. And believe me, that, you know, with all due respect to the commission, it's very hard to, the longer that we wait to revisit this, the longer, the more changes that will have happened rapidly. So having a light regulatory touch on this, I'll tell you just one little anecdote. Mick Mulvaney was appointed by President Trump to the Office of Management and Budget, the OMB. He was one of the original founders of a blockchain in D.C. He's one of the original tech geeks in the U.S. Congress that started this little. And there's lots of examples all around the world. Japan recently added cryptocurrency to their legal tender laws. This is a very rapidly moving thing. And for New Hampshire to try to pick a position and send a negative signal, Bitcoiners and cryptocurrency enthusiasts are very sensitive about these negative signals. So I think to allow this future industry to grow and plant its roots here in New Hampshire, I think that's why I'm in favor of this. So I'll end it there and take questions.
Thank you. Senator Lasky.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Very quickly, is there not a middle ground so that we can allow the industry to grow, clearly not in the wildlife to have Apple, but also in the event that the consumer needs protection?
Yeah, so consumer protection is very important.
So is there not a middle ground here, and you think this bill provides that? No, you're against it.
This bill, I'm in favor of the bill. I believe the bill is the middle ground, because 2 years ago there wasn't anything in statute about cryptocurrencies.
Okay.
I think, in my opinion, we had an overreaction to give it to this part of the bank. And this will be the middle ground of consumer protection, treating it as other transactions where someone might be defrauded and deserve restitution. So,
thank you.
I'm good.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate the testimony. Daryl Perry supports the bill, wishes to speak. Again, brevity, please.
I will try to be incredibly brief. Again, for the record, Daryl Perry, CEO of Liberty Lobby LLC. And I just want to read a little bit of statute, section 399-G:3. Leading up to where this would be added, the provisions of this chapter shall not apply to, first thing on the list, any bank, trust company, savings and loan, profit sharing, pension trust, credit union, thrift company, insurance company, or receivership, which is chartered in this or any state, or chartered by the United States government. Number two on the list, the United States government. Number three, any state, county, city, or other governmental agency. Then there's ETFs. Number five on the list is retailers issuing stored value credit or gift cards. These are things not regulated as money transmitters. Number six is debt adjuster duly licensed under 399D. So this would simply add to that list things that are not regulated as money transmitters. I think we can all remember about 8.5 years ago, something that's not on that list of money transmitters that wound up being considered too big to fail, to where they were just, you know, taking risk with people's monies. And I don't think anybody in this room would say that banks are not regulated at all. They're just not regulated. And here, they're, you know, exempt from money transmitters. One of the banking regulators said, do you want the FAA inspecting planes or the TSA inspecting wreckage? And I actually used to work for an airline, and the FAA did not inspect airplanes before they took off. The people that did inspect the airplanes were the pilots and the people that were working on the ramp. It was my job as a baggage handler when the plane came in to walk around and inspect for damage. If I noticed any damage, notify the pilot. The pilot would then independently come out, walk around, look for any damage. Before the plane left, again, either me or one of the other ramp agents and one of the flight crew would take another walk around to, again, make sure there's no damage. So it was the airlines inspecting their planes because they had the vested interest to make sure that there was not damage to their airplane. I would also like to encourage you to look at the original version of HB 356 as introduced in 2015 before it was amended to create the commission to study cryptocurrency regulations. I believe HB 356 as introduced has basically the same intent here And I tend to agree with Senator Sanborn that you may want to do two things, make this effective upon passage, and probably strike the reference to 358-A, which, again, is not mentioned in any of the other things that are exempt from money transmitters in 399G3, leading up to what would be subsection 126-A. And also, I believe I'm the only lobbyist in the country that actually accepts Bitcoin as a payment process. And there was a question about why would somebody want to go through a payment processor to accept the Bitcoin or other cryptocurrency? And there are various reasons. Say, for instance, you have a lobbyist business or a political party and you need to know who is sending you money. You need to have it set up through some kind of payment processing thing. And there are ways that you have to have some technical abilities to set up to where you can run your own node of Bitcoin and then implement somehow with HTML coding onto your website. Or you can go to Coinbase or BitPay or coinpayments.net, and they offer payment tools for you to where they collect the name and the address of the person sending you the cryptocurrency. So there are reasons that you would want to do that. Also, to make sure that I don't miss the decimal point, and instead of sending you $1 for the soda, I send you $100, which I actually did one time a couple of years ago at a corner store in King, New Hampshire. Luckily, she was using a payment processor and was able to just hit refund, and then I walked in and physically handed her $1 a couple of hours later. So I will answer any questions, and hopefully nobody else winds up getting too technical, because I think some people try to overcomplicate things.
Question. But when a Bitcoin, single Bitcoin is worth $1,000, it doesn't matter.
Yes.
All right. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Next up, speaking in opposition, is James Buffetti.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman.
Good.
My name is James Buffetti. I'm a senior assistant attorney general. I'm also chief of the Consumer Protection Bureau. We share the same concerns that Commissioner Little has. I want to be clear that the Consumer Protection Bureau of the AG's office does not regulate. We are a law enforcement agency. So we don't have any oversight. So we're not doing what the banking department would do with money transmitters, which is what we're talking about. We are not checking to see if they are people of good character who should be entrusted with transmitting people's money. That would not happen by the Department of Justice. We have no authority to do that. We would get involved after the harm was done. So a company would file a complaint saying that a money transmitter committed an unfair or deceptive business practice and that asked us to investigate it. Chairman Hunt, I think, is exactly right, that the reference to 358A is gratuitous in that taking it out will have absolutely no effect because it would still fall under the jurisdiction of 358A. 358A prohibits any unfair or deceptive trade or practice, but then there's an exemption clause that says that trade or commerce under the jurisdiction of the banking department is exempt from 358A. If you now remove this from the jurisdiction of the banking department, even if you say nothing about it, it by default will fall to the Department of Justice to look at it. But we don't have the same restitution capacities that the banking department does. We don't have their expertise in dealing with these issues. And frankly, I noticed that there was no fiscal note on this. I don't know, and I can't tell you what impact it would have to shift to the Department of Justice investigating these claims. I have no idea how many of these would come up. Maybe none. I have no idea. There is, as you probably know, and I think as Attorney Lehman said, there are two mechanisms within the Consumer Protection Act. There's a private right of action, which means you hire a lawyer and you can get treble damages. That's a separate thing. It has nothing to do with us. And then there is the Attorney General's role in bringing either civil or criminal enforcement actions for unfair or deceptive business practices. So we get these complaints, we look to see if there's proof of unfair deceptive acts, we can take an enforcement action. but the harm is already done. And so maybe we can get restitution, maybe we can't. Maybe we can find this person, and maybe we can't. There'd be no requirement this person would have to be accountable to register with the department, with the banking department, so we could actually find them. So chances are we couldn't even find them. And so if you can't find them, you can't bring an enforcement action against them. Thank you.
Questions?
Thank you.
All right, Ryan McGuire supports the bill and wishes to speak.
I have my notes written down, so I can move pretty quickly. Hello, my name is Ryan McGuire. I'm a resident of Grafton, New Hampshire. I've lived in the Grand Estate since 2008. I work out of my home as an open source software developer and entrepreneur. I have been involved personally with the Bitcoin space since about 2011. I have made development contributions to several Bitcoin-related software projects, including digital wallets and website payment gateways. I wanted to just introduce a little bit of philosophy that I have on this, and I liken this to the late 1990s. At the advent of this information age, internet pioneer Eric S. Raymond wrote an important essay that helped formulate the philosophical direction of the open source software movement that underpins Bitcoin to this day. He entitled this essay called The Cathedral and the Bazaar. He likened software developments happening one of two ways. The first way is like a cathedral, built by the state religion and designed and operated only by an elect few. The second way is like that of a bazaar, a natural marketplace grown organically through the free association of people. The cathedral model relies on extensive upfront design, often taking centuries, as these cathedrals did, planning to get everything right in one go, and placing the entire project into the hands of only a few. The bazaar model, in contrast, is one where the entire information age is built upon is much different. It is comprised of an entirely organic grown community. Eric describes this process in five different steps. Every good work of software starts by scratching a developer's personal itch. Good programmers know what to write, but great ones know what to rewrite. And he says to plan to throw one out, because you know that you will have to anyway. The first version is never going to be the right version that you want to continue with. And if you have the right attitude, interesting problems will find you. And finally, when you lose interest in a program, your last duty is to hand it off to someone else that is interested in the continuance of the project. I'm in favor of this bill because it supports this bizarre model. And here are my points. People with an itch probably won't scratch it if there's too much red tape involved. Experimentation and community development of how all the robust computational platforms we use today were designed. I believe that the state should not look to control this creative process, but look at how it can foster its growth by stepping out of the way and letting the network bootstrap itself. Money transmitter regulation would put this building process in the hands of only a few. It will make finding new developers interested in working in the space and with the necessary foundational lawmaking kind of mentality that just many people just will not have, and makes my job as an employer that much more difficult in finding people willing to work in that space. Limiting this process to only the politically favored would limit the brain pool of developers and prevent any organic network growth. Very seldom are the ones in control of the ones. Very seldom are the ones that have the control are the ones with the ideas to scratch. Thank you for your time and for listening to my point of view.
Thank you. Any questions?
No. You only have one here. I'm sorry, it's getting late, but I thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your outlook, which I think is wonderful. I don't want to stifle your creativity in any way. What I'm concerned about, and answer my question is, do you see any way that a consumer needs to be protected or could be harmed by what's going on?
So, one comment that I've heard over and over from the opposition is that the state does not regulate peer-to-peer transactions. And I see that as the reason for that is because, you know, man has a natural right to contract with other people. You know, if two people want to come and meet together and say, we're going to agree to do this thing, and you're going to give me such and such a thing, and I'm going to give you such and such a thing, what does the state have to give them? And according to the opposition, nothing does.
But when we're talking about a third party, I don't think that, that third parties in the classical economic model necessarily map to third parties in the new digital space. Holders of Bitcoin temporarily are not just individual actors that could necessarily run away with it. There are technical ways in which we can make contracts through code. And through this code, we can create a new model that doesn't have an analog to the old model. So it's not like I have the money, you have the money, then some third party has the money temporarily. There's new opportunities for new model creation, such that we can create contracts in code that do the regulation for us.
So just to follow, at the very least, should there not be hope warning, you know, that accompanies this? That, you know, again, this is not your father's goal.
Well, do we need warnings about yard sales? I mean,
all right.
I failed to ask anyone.
Thank you.
Yeah, what is Bitcoin based on when you talk of the value of it?
It's in the eye of the beholder.
It's like everything else. So when they say it's worth $1,000, or they can say it's worth 80 barrels of oil, or they can say it's worth batches of carrots.
You might have a certain perception of the value today, and I might have a different perception of that value today. And you know, I might pay a certain amount, and you might pay a different amount. It's all about perspective and where we think it's going and what it might be useful for. I mean, if I buy Bitcoin today, there's some things I can do with it, but I'm really buying Bitcoin so that I can use it for the things that we're about to build that don't exist.
All right, any further questions? All right. Thank you. We still have a number of speakers to go. I'm going to impose a 3-minute time limit on further speakers. And et cetera. So I'd like to ask Chris Reitman to please come forward to support a mission to speak. Welcome, sir.
How are you?
I'm sorry for the timer.
That's okay. Chairman of the committee. I operate a small business in Key, New Hampshire. I sell local goods. I make Bitcoin and dozens of other cryptocurrencies for syrup and jam and jelly and all kinds of things. And we also operate a Bitcoin vending machine where people can come and purchase Bitcoin. Before I came down here today, I saw New York State license plates in our parking lot. People that had driven up from the Albany area to purchase Bitcoin. New York, as you may be aware, has taken a very strict view of Bitcoin and of blockchain technologies, and it's become onerous on their people. It did not start out that way in New York. They wanted to address the same sorts of concerns that the regulators up here have. But I can also say, and I want to speak a little bit about third parties. Third parties are absolutely necessary for me to efficiently do business. I operate through third parties. The marketplace can tell me which ones are reliable, which ones are not. If they are not, they do not get my business. And fortunately, with billions of dollars going to Bitcoin companies every year, the choices that I have to choose from are growing constantly. I wanted to speak a little bit about consumers getting scammed, because that is the reality that I see people come in purchasing actual Bitcoin because they've been hit with ransomware on their PC and they've been told that they have to send Bitcoin anonymous transaction to get their data back. That's the first thing. The second thing is people that come in and say that, wow, I've got this great deal on a car I bought on eBay, but they want me to pay with Bitcoin. And it's a scam. We see that frequently. None of the regulations that have been discussed will ever address that peer-to-peer scam, and that's where things really go. No company
that is going into the blockchain space, a young fledgling industry, has any interest, potential interest, in making a quick buck off of scamming people or doing things improperly. And that's all I have.
Any questions? I'm impressed. One quick question. I mean, those scams exist in traditional monetary markets.
Absolutely. Right? And we can't stop them there either. Okay.
All right. Question?
Yeah. Well,
if you have one.
No. The scam, but you have.
Okay.
All right. Very good.
Thank you,
sir. Appreciate it. Keith, can't read your last name. Keith supports the bill, wishes to speak. Is there a Keith in the room?
That's probably State Rep. Ann. State Rep, you already spoke.
Okay, great. Thank you. Will Anderson, supporting, does not indicate whether he wishes to speak or not.
No.
All right. Thank you, sir. Ian Freeman, supports, wishes to speak.
Okay. I'm Ian Freeman, I'm the co-chairman of the New Hampshire Liberty Party, and I've been involved in reporting all of these hearings that had happened at the Commerce Committee, and so there's been a lot of discussion about this before it's hit your committee. And one of the things I remember the Banking Commission testifying about, they were asked specifically, I believe, by Chairman Hunt, how many complaints they'd received about cryptocurrency or Bitcoin, and the answer was zero. So far, there have been no complaints about it. I think that was pretty enlightening. And it seems to me like, you know, there's been, from the people who opposed this bill, a lot of kind of fear-mongering of, oh, we need to be there to prevent all of these terrible things from happening. Well, the reality is the people running these Bitcoin businesses, these third-party businesses, they can choose where to set up business. They don't have to set up business here in New Hampshire. This is an international currency, and people all around the globe are using this. So they're going to set up in the jurisdictions that are most favorable to them. So it doesn't matter to them if they set up in Hong Kong, they set up in California, or in Keene, New Hampshire. If New Hampshire's regulations are less than attractive, they're just going to cross it off the list. And certainly the international businesses aren't going to bother to get any kind of approval process from New Hampshire because they don't need it. It doesn't matter to them. So you're just going to miss out by having regulation of Bitcoin. You're just going to miss out on those businesses that would otherwise move here because they've heard that New Hampshire is a burgeoning Bitcoin place. But I can tell you that when the news came out about 666, the headlines in the Bitcoin industry were, you know, live free or die, what a joke. New Hampshire had become a laughingstock. It looked like to the people in the Bitcoin field that New Hampshire was going to be more like New York than like New Hampshire. And New Hampshire is supposed to be this live free or die place. So I hope that this will get through you guys and pass the Senate and ultimately become law, because I think it will send out that message again, like, hey, we made a mistake. This is the way it should be in New Hampshire. We're not like New York. We're the opposite of New York. We want to encourage Bitcoin businesses to come in here. And I real quick wanted to address the questions just from a slightly different perspective of what is blockchain. The best way I've heard it described is like a public ledger. So you've seen a ledger that you've worked on, perhaps for your accounting. Imagine a giant public ledger that is spread all around the world and that any amount of people can look at. That's what the blockchain is. You can move money from one point to another on the ledger. That's what Bitcoin is in this case. So if you want to ask
a question. No. I'm sorry, Matt. But no one else does that? Why is it any different?
The difference is that Bitcoin is decentralized in its structure. So your typical ledger exists in your file cabinet, right? If the house burns down, if you didn't have a backup copy of that ledger, then sorry, all your financials are gone. But with Bitcoin, it's decentralized, meaning that it's also distributed to thousands of different nodes on the Bitcoin network located all around the globe. So if one person's computer who's a part of that network goes down or crashes or something like that, well, there's thousands more that have a full copy of that ledger on their computer. So it's basically immutable. It can't be hacked. It cannot be deleted. And it can't be regulated. So as much as the governments of the world would like to try to regulate Bitcoin, ultimately they can't do that. Let's see here real quick. Also, I think that pretty much covers what I had to say. I do want to invite you, Senator Lasky and Senator French. I noticed that you have smartphones in your hands. You guys are obviously busy with hearings today, but if you want, you know, you've seen me around here. I'm frequently in these hearings. If you want to spend 5 minutes with me, I'd be happy to get you set up with your first Bitcoin wallet. All the wallet software is free, and I'll send you your first $10 worth of Bitcoin. I don't know if that's a bribe. I'm not trying to bribe you. It's easier than you think. If you want to try it out, just come see me, and I'll get you hooked up. Happy to answer any questions.
Blockchain.
Thank you, Mr. Freeman. Appreciate your testimony.
I'm sorry. Is it?
I have no idea.
Is it blockchain?
Blockchain is the technology that is sort of backing Bitcoin. And I would be happy to share a Bitcoin wallet software for your phone.
There will be a tutorial after.
Thank you.
All right. In the meantime, we need to move on. So thank you, Mr. Freeman. Christopher Wade supports wishes to speak. 3 minutes or less, please.
Okay, so I'm a New Hampshire resident. I'm Christopher Wade. I am a business owner, a small business owner that deals with technology and freedom, security, privacy aspects of it. And I want my customers basically to be secure in their devices and well in their online digital exchanges. And Bitcoin enables that. And regulating it basically is counter to that objective. Unfortunately, a lot of the issues that have been discussed here today have been conflated. Where they actually lie, what's being regulated is not can't solve the fraud issue. You can regulate the intermediary, okay? And I would say that's a bad thing, but that doesn't prevent Bitcoins from being sent. It doesn't prevent Bitcoins from being bought. So if somebody in Africa tries to get somebody who doesn't know much about technology or fraud issues, they're still going to get tricked into it. They're still going to get a scam. This doesn't solve that problem. If we actually do end up with regulation as far as intermediary is concerned, I am certainly going to be pulling out and not using an intermediary anymore. This is counter to my interests as a business owner. I'm already considering pulling out of the intermediary market and having somebody else hold my money. It's not necessarily the best idea, but the reality is we actually have had basically unregulated intermediaries for a very long time, and I've never had a problem. I've been, I think it's 2011 was when I first started accepting Bitcoin with my business, and we've never had a problem. It saves us about 3% over credit card fees, which means we actually have more profit in some cases on laptop sales online as a result than we actually, we make more money from the savings, the 3% savings, than we actually make profit off the actual selling of the laptop. You do not want to hinder this market from developing, because it brings money and improves the economy in New Hampshire. So I just wanted to also just quickly explain why people don't want to use third parties. It basically makes it very easy to start accepting Bitcoins. This is one of the key reasons that people start using it. It literally took me 3 minutes to set up my company for accepting Bitcoins. It would have taken me a little bit longer probably if I had to implement the system in a different way. And it really didn't matter, even if it wasn't a perfect system, because ultimately, when you first start accepting Bitcoins, you're not going to be accepting this. You're not going to get as many people paying in Bitcoins. So if you do run into a problem, you can always swap to a different intermediary, or you can completely eliminate the intermediary altogether if you want. That's all up to you. That's all up to the consumer. One of the other reasons I'm objecting to this regulations is it's basically, they say that some big players basically, or some players want regulation. Well, that's actually not true. What was said in some of the committee hearings prior was basically that we will deal with the regulations because it's basically being forced on us. So to the extent that people may someday want regulations, it's probably going to be because it's going to inhibit smaller competitions from getting into that industry, into this market. That's why they want it, not necessarily, or would want it, because again, like I said, nobody's actually asking for that. It was very misleading the way that was phrased by the regulators. Okay.
Final statement.
Oh, okay, so one last thing. Bitcoin has value in transmission, and it's rarity. That's why it's worth something. And the savings that it gets you, because it costs less than credit cards.
No, you're all set up now. All right, thank you very much. Appreciated your testimony. David Juris, supports wishing to speak.
Hi, I'm David.
Hi, David, 3 minutes.
I support this bill. I'm actually new to New Hampshire, moved to Keene last summer.
Welcome.
Some of the reasons I moved here, low taxes, low regulation, it's an easy place to start a business. Currently, I have a computer repair business. I'm also a member of an organization called Shire Bitcoin, where we go around the state trying to encourage businesses to accept Bitcoin. And recently, I launched Concord's first Bitcoin vending machine. It's at a local restaurant and bar called Area 23. So yes, definitely support it. My recommendation, if you want to grow the economy here, if you want people to start businesses here, grow the job market, keep the regulations low, keep the taxes low, we'll come in and build up this place. Thanks.
Well, I was good at 49 seconds. So we have 2 minutes for questions, if anyone.
Can he pass us 2 minutes to the next
Why do you look to your right?
Do I need to keep going?
No, you're good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very much. Appreciate your testimony. Thank you, sir. The final speaker today is Robert Call, supporting wishing to speak.
I'll try to keep this brief. I'm Robert.
You've got an extra 2 minutes, courtesy of the previous speaker.
No, I think everyone has spoken.
It's a big cover, hasn't it?
Yes, pretty much. So I'm Robert Call. I'm from Keene, New Hampshire. I've lived off and on in the Grand State since 2000. I support this bill because, again, these regulations won't do what they, you know, it won't protect the consumer, if that's the concern. Because, you know, once you send bitcoins to somewhere, you know, that's it. You can't really do a charge back. And then if the person who ripped, you know, this other person off, if you want to try to go after them, they're most likely not in the Grand State, so they're out of, you know, your jurisdiction and possibly out of any regulation wherever they may be. So most of everyone else has already said what I wanted to say, so.
Okay.
That's
well, much it. Appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. All right. Is there anyone we may have missed who would like to speak to the bill? We've accumulated 3 minutes' time, so you're welcome to it.
I'll be really quick. Thanks for hearing me. My name is Heather Mullins, and I'll just speak to the third party analogy. I would say if you're worried about a third party in terms of doing business, adding a fourth party is kind of like saying, you know, I wonder if 3 drinks is too much to put me over the limit. I think I'll add a fourth. So I think that in terms of regulation, you have a market that's international right now. So there's already regulation. It's a world of users that are only going to use something if they see value in it. So by limiting the regulation to a small group of people, you're doing exactly what everyone else said. You're hindering it. Nobody's going to want to get involved because it's almost like saying, we don't trust you to make good decisions. And not only that, but also the third parties that currently that operate in the Bitcoin industry, they have that vested interest in providing a good service. Otherwise, the competing third parties are going to get the business if they fail to do their job. So I support this bill, and I don't think we need to add a fourth party. That's it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, and with that final bit of testimony, I will. Yes,
thank you. Okay, I'd like to tell you.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. On the downside, could this not ultimately, if there's no regulations, no monitoring, et cetera, be a huge way to launder money or some other nefarious activities?
I'm happy to have a crack at that. The IRS has looked into that recently, and I think it was Coinbase, someone in the audience might be able to help me, that was asked to turn over a lot of information related to such activity. So there is regulation of that sort of thing presently through existing laws and rules. So,
thank
yes.
You.
Anything further? Okay, I'm going to close the hearing on House Bill 436. Thank you all. I did not anticipate such an extensive hearing on this one, but I do appreciate the comments. It was valuable, and I think we all learned something.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.